Penguin Random House Audio presents We Love the Nightlife by Rachel Koller Croft. Read for you by Suzanne Elise Freeman and Katharine Lee McEwan. For my disco-loving mom. And for my dad, who, according to her, hated that whole thing. Except for one song. Prologue. I should have known the party was over when she casually suggested killing my husband back in 1981. I shut her down immediately, but I never forgot the way she said it. With a quick shrug of the shoulder, up and down like a spasm. Her dark eyes rolling up to the ceiling, painted lips pushed together with a small, as if she was innocently putting the ball in my court, like we were just deciding what to do with the rest of our night. Acting as though she wasn't making a literal threat on his life while she let the needle drop on a Donna Summer album, her voice warbling around us about bad girls and sad girls. Message received. Yes, I left my husband, but I never wished death on him. So I did what she asked me to do, and she promised we wouldn't hurt him. But since he was still looking for me in London, we had to stay home. Well, I did. Nicola was always free to do as she pleased. How could I not see that it was only going to get worse? So much worse. Maybe because I couldn't even imagine the betrayal that was coming my way. I didn't know yet that she did this to everyone she cared about, past and present. How could any of us have known at the beginning? Nobody anticipates the hit from behind, especially when you're supposed to be on the same goddamn team. It didn't even cross my mind to try to leave Nicola back then. I mean, where was I gonna go? I didn't have anyone else. She was my brand new best friend in a brand new city. Why wouldn't I trust her when I was a total amateur and she was an old pro? Emphasis on the old. There was just something about Nicola that was so irresistible to me when we met. Yes, she was funny and vivacious and beautiful. The two of us together grabbed the attention of everyone in the room, even when we weren't trying. But it was the way Nicola answered to no one but herself, taking anything she wanted, whenever she wanted, that really got my attention. She had her own money, she had her own home, she was self-possessed, wise, and whip-smart. She suffered no fools and had zero issue with burning any bridge she saw fit to set on fire. Did I really think I'd avoid getting singed myself one day? More than that, scorched. On the night we first met at Tramp, I instantly recognized Nicola, even though rationally I knew I'd never seen her before in my life. But we were two sides of the same record. I can cop to being the A side. The hits, the crowd pleasers, the lead single that pulls you in. But that's why I liked Nicola so much. She was the B side, the dark, the weird, the experimental, but with the potential to break through with the right crowd, the right person, to appreciate her for what she was. Extraordinary. I think that was part of her strategy all along. Not just with me, but with all of us. Every single so-called treasured friend that she deceived. She told us we'd live forever with her. Eternal youth. And that she would take care of everything for us. Nothing to worry about ever again. When you're a good-time girl in a bad situation with seemingly no other way out, how are you going to turn down an offer like that? Nicola made it seem like we had a choice, but I'm not sure we ever did. Once you were in her sights, she wouldn't let you out. Nicola knew what she was doing, what she was taking from me, from the others. From her sister, too, even though she won't admit it to herself. It was her past that dictated all our futures. We just couldn't see it. But I see it now. Still, I never thought our friendship would come to this, a place so dark that I don't even recognize myself anymore. But it's the only way out. It makes sense, in a sick sort of way. all things considered. We're vampires. The darkness is all we know. It's all we have. Chapter 1. Amber. Sometimes, when I was alone, I'd follow my husband and his third wife around central London at night. Not like a complete psycho, but I'd see what they were up to in Mayfair or Marylebone. It was hard to believe he'd be out after sunset since he never wanted to bebop around town with me when we were together. No, Malcolm Wells liked to curl up with a dusty old book about World War II to wind down on a weekend, sipping on a hot toddy or a cup of tea until it ran cold. Even way back then when he was still only in his 30s. He'd always been an old fogey in a young guy's body. But soon enough, and much faster than I'd like to admit, he was old, and so was his current wife, Geraldine. Still, there he was, regularly taking her out on dates in the city, enjoying their retirement together. Dinner, drinks, the theater. I guess the third wife was the charm. Malcolm was probably mortified when I started going out alone without him, not long after we got married in the summer of 79, but what was I supposed to do? Sit around and listen to him spout off facts about Winston Churchill? I mean, respectfully, who cares? I was 23 years old, and come on, we're only young once. Or so I thought at the time. When we met earlier that year, Malcolm said he was attracted to my joie de vivre, and I swooned. Just imagine some sophisticated British man speaking French to you when you're a small-town Wisconsin girl who came to Chicago for the day, only to get rejected at the Rockettes audition you've been waiting for your whole life. I was devastated when they didn't call my name. It was supposed to be my ticket to a whole new life. I really didn't want to go back home to my miserable family, who wanted to control my every move. So, as I was drowning my sorrows at some fancy businessman bar in River North before getting the late train to Milwaukee, Malcolm swooped in with his accent and handsomeness and money, offering to fly me back to London with him instead. Listen, it was the 70s and we were delightfully tipsy, and how could I reject such a juicy invitation? I'd never been out of the country before. What was meant to be a one-week jaunt on some richy-rich fella's dime quickly turned into something serious, and before I knew it, we were engaged. I fell in love with London the second I got here. And yes, I probably got that mixed up with true love for Malcolm, which now seems a little nuts. It would be a few months before I admitted it to myself, but we were a god-awful match. Unless it was for business reasons, he wasn't much for being social, and all I ever wanted to do was flit around town. Go dancing, see live music and shows, alongside other young people. But Malcolm? It was books, tea, the BBC, and repeat. Nightmare. Not that I knew what real nightmares were just yet. I didn't tell anyone back home in Wisconsin about my potential screw-up. It was a different time, and I'd never confided much in my parents. Everyone was always hanging on by a thread as it was. Emotionally, financially. And I knew my dad would have just said something about getting what I deserved after being so impulsive. My mother didn't have too much to say about it, but she didn't protest either. Money talks, obviously, and Malcolm had it. We never did, so Godspeed to her eldest daughter. One less thing to worry about. And she still had the little one. I feel bad about leaving my sister behind this day, but I try not to think about it. The first time I revisited Malcolm, after I left him and after I turned, it was the early 90s. He was still in his second marriage with Cheryl, the show pony with no personality, who was also the mother of all three of his small children, so I figured he'd be up for a cheap thrill. Enough time had passed by then, over 10 years, and I didn't see how a quick cameo would cause much of a fuss. The two of them were having a nightcap at the American Bar in the Stafford Hotel, not the Savoy. Way too much of a scene over there for Malcolm, with the chatty pianist and the tourists, and the hustle-bustle of the Strand. The Stafford was understated and classic, tucked away on a quiet street not far from St. James's Park. Honestly, I had always liked it too. For kicks, I asked for my usual...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.